¿Se escucha bien? Buenas tardes. Buenas tardes a todos. Buenas tardes a todas las personas asistentes hoy aquí, en especial a los y las estudiantes del Máster en Migraciones Contemporáneas, título interuniversitario entre la Universidad Autónoma de Barcelona y la Universidad de Barcelona, y que hoy iniciamos, gracias a la colaboración que mantenemos con el IEMET, nuestro ciclo anual de conferencias, y hoy tenemos nuestra primera conferencia del Aula Mediterránea, curso 23-24. Así que agradecer también a todas la presencia hoy aquí. Voy a cambiar al inglés para nuestro ponente. It's a great pleasure for us to have the opportunity today to listen to know the work of Theodoros Fuskas. He's an assistant professor at the University of Attica Occidental in Athens, Greece. His research is focused on sociology with an emphasis on migration and public health. He's specialized in many, many topics, but also especially migrant health and employment. He has also carried out different studies on precarious, low status paid work for migrants, integration of third country nationals, undeclared work, irregular migration, migrants' access to health care, political participation, trade unions. He has published a lot of papers, monographs, such as Precarious Lives of Meds, Nannies and Caregivers in Greece, Perceptions of Migrant Filipino Life in Domestic Workers or Labor. Has also co-edited the collective volume Contemporary Migration in Greece, a source book, and he has edited collective volumes such as Immigrants, Asylum Seekers and Refugees in Times of Crisis, an international handbook on migration and refugee studies. All these publications very connected to the research interests of migrations and also our master. Today he's going to talk about a very, very interesting topic. The title is Unveiling Migrant and Refugee Integration During and Beyond the COVID-19 Pandemic, a comparative study between Greece and Spain. He has told me it's the first time he's going to present the results of this research. This is a comparative research project titled Local Alliance for Integration, Migrant and Refugee Integration into Local Societies During the COVID in Greece and Spain. So it's a great privilege for us to share with you this inedit results we are going to present today. Thank you very much for coming, for accepting our invitation, for being here today, and when you want, the floor is yours.
First of all, hello, hola. This is where I stop my Spanish is stopped there. I would like to thank particularly the organizers and the EMED board. Particularly Professor Moya, Professor Pamies, and Professor Paella, as well as Dr. Sharif and Dr. Tavernel for their invitation. I'm grateful to be here and to be able to share with you results of a comparative study. We have worked and presented the Greek results, but it's the first time that and I'm honored to present these findings for Spain and Greece in a comparative level here at the EMED and the Aula Mediterranea. So we know, and this is important, that the flows of migration, and particularly in South European countries, it is not a new phenomenon. It is not something that you researchers and scholars have met for, let's say, since 2015 or later. It is a phenomenon that has multiple impacts on the individuals, on their families. We know that the decision of migration is not an easy task. It is a perilous journey, it's a perilous procedure. The push and pull factors and, of course, the dimensions that are actually impact each individual do not begin in the reception countries, but as we have seen, maybe are combined in many cases from the countries of origin. The presentation for the next 35 minutes, 40 minutes, I will be presenting you based on this context, the results. First of all, starting with an introduction, we do understand that the flows, even in 2023, in 2024, are intense. We've seen people to be on the move for multiple reasons. Particularly the South European countries have to deal not only with the humanitarian, not only for search and rescue individuals, but also to try to offer those opportunities for the next steps, actually. Somebody, when he or she decides, or he or she is forced to leave his residence, his reality, his neighborhood, he tries to set up particular contacts in a new country, in a new destination. We do understand that, particularly based on these data and recordings of the UNHCR, is that the individuals have to deal not only with an instability in the country of origin, and you will see that the topics that, of the pillars of integration that are actually analyzed here, the five pillars that I will present you in a few minutes, are actually pillars that have been shattered, have been affected severely in the countries of origin. This could be something that the individual on the move tries to re-establish and develop a particular basis for his or her next steps. This is a picture just before the pandemic. Within the actually 30 days before the first positive case in Greece. It is in one of the islands of where we have established the hotspots. This is taken in Chios Island. These are the conditions that the person, after escaping violence, fleeing for his or her life, trying to even decide to move to another country temporarily in order to retain some sources and support with remittances his family or persons left behind. Let's not forget that migration historically has a particular role to help those individuals left behind and are still experiencing a sort of crisis. Could be unemployment, could be instability, could be multiple factors, or actually taking place at the same time. So, after the search and rescue procedure, after the first reception procedure, the person has to deal not only with difficult, let's say, it's a very polite word to describe those conditions, also met on the other islands, but what happens next, even when they are transferred to the mainland, as particularly in the case of Greece, is that the individuals have to meet other challenges. The challenges of housing, the challenge of formal employment, generally the labor market, the challenge of healthcare and social protection, the challenge of social, of intercultural coexistence, and of course, educational issues. These are the five pillars that not only research, not only the European Union, not only the European Commission takes in consideration, for example, in the European Migration Network, and the studies that develops, but the challenges are, of course, affecting in multiple ways the individual and, of course, creating perceptions, understandings. And this is quite problematic, especially when we see that the individuals have to deal with those parameters with very few, let's say, opportunities ahead of them. So what we have seen from research in Greece, in Europe, outside Europe, in the US, it's that the COVID had a significant impact on the migrant and refugee individuals and asylum seekers. The results here actually are focused on a project funded by the General Secretariat for Research and Innovation. I was a scientific director, and with my team, we tried to focus on these five particular sectors that you see, these particular pillars of integration. The The sample is consisted of in-depth interviews with migrants and refugees in Attica in Greece, and we collected 32 interviews, and in Spain, 15 with the team there. The qualitative methodology implemented tried to investigate, to understand the perceptions and the practices that have actually developed over their stay, over their everyday existence in these environments, and of course to see the implications that have emerging in this particular context. First of all, starting with what the international organizations underline, what they highlight is that the individuals on the move are actually experiencing multiple perilous situations. They are on a continuous risk. This could be for their safety, this could be for their health, and these, of course, are not they do not end in a, let's say, in a system that of welfare that's not working in their countries, that it is having not the capacity to cover the population. For example, in Afghanistan, we know that from studies that the life expectancy is lower due to the fact that the total population doesn't have access to medical hospitals, or the medical hospitals that exist are quite few for the general population. So in taking consideration, for example, that they have to walk about 2.5 hours to get to the nearest health center. So what they meet after... from what they try to escape, what they try to, let's say, reimagine and try to establish the sense is not only unhygienic living conditions, it's not only problems with the conditions and the processes that they apply and they have to meet, but also multiple problems that have to do with those five pillars that I mentioned before. But before analyzing them, is that these contexts of the pillars are being severely affected from other parameters. This is, of course, I'm giving you some understandings, especially of the parameters of gender, taking into consideration that we're, of course, discussing about the feminization of migration among the flows and generally on the people on the move. Also, we've seen that ethnic and racial discrimination impacts them on multiple ways. And, of course, we've seen that xenophobic and racist behaviors reemerged and actually increased during the pandemic. I will give you some examples in a few minutes, especially in the case of Greece. During even when they are in a facility of a temporary residence on an island, or later if they are transferred on the mainland, they are subject to aggression, they are subject to false characterizations, they are blamed for many evils in a society. But also, don't forget that the ways that they are offered to them are covered most of the cases with an identification, with low status, with marginality, with forms of living conditions that are not chosen, are not a priority, of course, on the labor market, on the area of residence, of ways of living for the native population. So the lack of advancement, the lack of opportunities that they have to deal with are leading not only to poor life opportunities, but also social exclusion. The multiple forms that violence... we've seen that especially with female migrants, violence within the facilities that has to do with gender-based violence. We've seen women not being to have a great fear to go out of their container in the night due to the fear of abuse. But this is not only the case. It's not the hour. The problem is that even when they leave the facility, they are still experiencing multiple ways of racism and xenophobia. What we have recorded in the desk research, one of the packages of the program, it was to try to identify anti-migrant sentiments, those mobilizations that have to do with the negative attitude towards the migrants, not only, of course, in Greece, in Spain, but throughout the EU. Of course, I will mention some results only for the two countries, but I will give you some information about publications that we have already prepared, and you will soon be able to find it. They are subject to anti-migrant rhetoric, and you can easily identify it not only on media, but also on the political discourse, and society is, of course, create perceptions about them that entail the practices that actually cast them off from and exclude them very frequently from any possibilities of progress. The language barriers, there are also, and this is one of the tools, for example, for their racism that we have recorded, of course, the skin color, issues, the origin, the even cultural attributes that are associated with the negative understanding. Another issue that is quite important, it is not only the hateful rhetoric. It is the practice and the behavior they have to deal with, especially in local communities, that are visible at any aspect that they try to develop a source of progress. We've seen that particularly the media during the pandemic affected the presence and the understandings about migrants. You will see some examples, for example, at the school environments, parents blocking the entrance of a school facility or employers not allowing offering any jobs to them. We've seen some of recordings also in public transport. You will have seen some of those results. But before moving on, we need to take into consideration something what's quite important, that what has been initially affected is the quality of life of the individual. When I'm saying quality of life, you will see that when we take into consideration not only on international studies, but also on micro level and meso and macro level of analysis, that the social determinants are decisive. And of course, these entail parameters that can be very, very distinct for migrants' progress. Especially during the pandemic, these social determinants have been severely affected, and of course, we will see that one of them is, of course, the living environment. They face difficulties to deal with the labor market and quality housing, actually. They face very limited opportunities in the neighborhoods, then the residences. They are actually pushed and entrapped in areas that are having problems. For example, are disconnected from the public transportation. They are not well preserved. They are having conditions that are not chosen by the most, as we can see, especially. Another issue is that the lack of access on formal employment affect their nutritious, affordable food that they have access. They also, especially if we see older people, they are, of course, in peril as well. Another sector of these social determinants is the healthcare. They have here, as we have identified, not only barriers. They don't only face barriers accessing healthcare. They have difficulties in their everyday needs. They have actually dealt with bureaucratic systems in order to establish access, especially during the pandemic, even for the vaccinations, and before the pandemic, this was something evident, and we have multiple studies that have identified that. Another category here that needs to be taken into consideration is, of course, the occupations. And, of course, the, as we know, the labor market and, of course, the dual labor market that each society has to deal with, especially with the approaches of Pioré, actually represents and creates a context of precarity, a low pay, and unequal division in the labor market, and entraps them in specific sectors of the economy, the agricultural sector, foment, the constructions, the hotel sector, the food chains, and other, we have seen, of course, in the food production, and women are found mostly in domestic work, in care provision of the elderly, of the children, and generally cleaning services. We've seen that these jobs, of course, are not attractive, have a very limited, create limited, actually, prospects for and opportunities, even for remittances, even for the, to deal with everyday challenges that they have to meet. And during the pandemic, let's not forget that these jobs are not characterized by the ability of the worker to have an absence. He cannot work from home and, of course, cannot have any social insurance. Most of, in particular context, they are undeclared, and they are mostly found in a condition of precarity. A few weeks ago, I was discussing that with my colleagues earlier. I'm now conducting a research on these sectors that we always have heard a lot of those, also in Spain, also in Italy, discussing about the agricultural sector. And another one is the gig economy, those people that actually transfer goods or food during the orders. Another social determinant of migrant and refugee health is, of course, their income. They cannot accumulate funds. They have debts. Don't forget that even the migration process creates is based on links that actually create that conditions, and they, in the end, they are unable to send remittances. They cannot pay for health coverage in case of they have to access private care, in case of if they are uninsured, to cover those medical bills, access housing or better housing, even nutritious food or even childcare. Another pillar here is the educational parameter. They are disproportionately affected by inequities in accessing formal education. I'm not discussing only for adults, especially in Greece we have difficulties. We have seen more atypical forms of their support. I mean, to learn the Greek language, we have seen programs of international organizations to help them access the courses of the Greek language or the English language. And as you understand, children also facing a lot of barriers, especially with the school environment, and of course during the pandemic. Education is a crucial pillar as well, because it can lead to lower literacy, limited school completion rates, and in the end, very poor access to quality job and restrictive future opportunities. This is something that in interviewees mentioned that during the pandemic, but even before the pandemic, they didn't have much opportunities to learn the language in their facility or when they were out of the facility. We do understand that the failure to deal with the social determinants of health increases vulnerability, and these groups actually are affected. They are exposed to inequalities, and the example here that we have seen, especially not only in Europe but also in the United States, about the Chinese, for example, individuals who were blamed, or other groups, for example, the media in Greece or in other countries, have we can see, and of course literature studies that show the characterizations and the false, actually, characterizations as unwanted, as dangerous, as uneducated, and as people who take the jobs of the natives. Of course, all these create an understanding, and they are incorporated in the everyday dealings, in the political discussions, and the media create more and more in a field of opportunities, creates more barriers. And what we have implemented here as a theoretical and research paradigm as a basis is that the precarity pre-exists. And during the pandemic, we have seen an increased precarity. And what we try to see if they have an increased exclusion, exploitation of other precarity, and take in consideration that the pandemic played a particular role even on the populist agenda, and of course the promotion of COVID populism, and of course, as you understand, these entail the migrants and refugees. What also is evident from the researchers is that we've seen that health literacy and the lack of health insurance and the unsafe environment that and the opportunities that are very limited create conditions that lead to further exploitation and intensify their precarity. Another issue here is that during the measures that they were implemented during the pandemic, taking into consideration the uncertainty, taking into consideration the anti-vaccination movements and hesitancy in this particular context, migrants, and if we take the example of Greece, actually even the measures had the directions to create an isolated environment for them. While the measures for tourists and other categories were lifting. And at the same time, we've seen that even in the vaccination procedures, this was actually implemented with a severe delay. Of course, during in this context, legal instabilities, precarity in the employment status, and of course, the conditions that they have to meet every day create this vulnerability. So another parameter that we tried, as I mentioned earlier, to see, it is the rise of what we have seen to be approached theoretically is the pandemic populism, and giving particular emphasis in the attitudes, the negative attitudes towards migrants and refugees. Here I have some examples from Greece, for example, in the train station of Lianokadi, when an individual from Cameroon who was forced to sit on the floor during the whole journey, and the police later on was called. He was checked for COVID, but he was not positive. He was having also a health certificate with him of vaccination. Another case in Chios, in Athens Thessaloniki route, for the typo there, another train with Bangladeshi nationals actually was stopped, and the passengers asked for them to remove, to disembark, and the authorities, of course, did that. Another point here is that we can use here, it is in the educational context. Parents not to be negative on the presence of children that were being transferred from the facilities to reception classes to attend the school program. And for example, here the mayor of Kilkis mentioned that the justification of the parents, he mentioned, was that they cannot be integrated, they cannot learn, they sacrifice the future of the children and endangering public health. So they have to remain maybe forever in detention or in isolation. In Lesbos, for example, you have seen the solidarity movements during the 2015-2016 flows of Syrians and other people on the move, fleeing for their lives and or even trying to reach a refuge. Here we've seen the other side, people not allowing boats or vessels to reach the ports or to reach the shores. We've seen the other side of the behavior. Of course, we do understand that the local societies were under pressure for years. The local societies had to deal with particular challenges, but at the same time, we've seen that in this context, migrants, of course, are exposed. In another case, here's during the pandemic, an individual was searching for migrants because he wanted them to leave his island, as he might bring COVID-19. Another case in Spain, for example, under the public health measures, notifying the number of people infected with coronavirus, it differentiated particularly on the context of the Spanish press between people, general people, and migrants, trying to make visible the number of migrants who were infected. The several immigrants in quarantine expelled and between ill insults, and of course people were shouting in a bus that was transferring them, "I hope the bus gets fire with you inside." A few things about the methodology. First of all, 32 interviews in Greece, 15 in Spain, 47 in total. We conducted thematic analysis, and the Research Ethics Committee ensured that the whole process will be taken into consideration with respect to the privacy and data of the participants. The sample, of course, here it doesn't. We have categorized the qualitative data with thematic analysis, but here just showing to you some of the data. But I will be discussing them with their own experiences, and this is actually something that interests you. So, the main question of the research: how actually has pandemic affected their integration? Starting with healthcare. We've seen that majority, for example, of the interviews, I will be presenting some examples from Greece and similarly in the case of Spain. The majority of the interviews reported that in Greece they have visited a public hospital at least once for themselves or their children to receive medical care or medication. For example, one woman from Iraq reported taking medication for hypertension, diabetes. Some of them were referred to psychologists due to stressful conditions they have met. They usually make an appointment with the assistance of the officials in the facility. Many actually mentioned the difficulties in accessing healthcare in Greece due to the problems they have with the identification numbers, the national health insurance numbers they have to issue. The absence of interpreters, particularly at the healthcare sector, is crucial. They hinder the communication with medical personnel and the beneficiary and the person who wants to receive care. The difficulties in communication was something that was underlined a lot of times, and the also ignorance that they met during the period of reference. One woman from Iraq, she went to the hospital not feeling well, but the doctors insisted she was healthy. "I went to the hospital because I was not well. There, they told me there is nothing wrong with you." and of course the personnel of the facility was re-referring her for at least 5 times. On the other hand, of course, we've seen that the staff of the facilities was quite friendly, and they tried to alleviate the pressure of the pandemic and the measures implemented. We've seen that in this particular context, the provision of information from the international organizations or the staff of the facility was crucial. For example, one female from Congo reported that while the refugee facilities on the Aegean Islands, the executive informed them about the measures, about the protective measures, it was not the same on other facilities. So what we saw was also an imbalance of information provided to migrants in the facilities. The fear and misunderstandings and, of course, misconceptions about the measures and how even the protection measures that have to be implemented created fear. We saw multiple examples, for example, of individuals not wanting to take an initiative. We were actually waiting for information that was quite difficult for them to receive them, actually. Regarding the vaccination, we've seen that only 3 from the Greek sample were vaccinated at the time of the interviews. This can be understood due to multiple, issues and parameters. Some had scheduled only 2 persons, if I remember correctly, had scheduled the interview. The vaccination, but all the others are skeptical about the whole procedure. The lack of information was crucial and is directly associated with that. And as you can see, they are affected like the Greeks, for example, on the public understanding of the issue. I'm not vaccinated because I do not want to be injected with something, the vaccine I do not know. Not all Greeks have been vaccinated. It was the understanding of a male from Syria. Another individual from Congo said that although he was initially afraid, he finally decided to get vaccinated because his friends had done so. Moving on to another section, in order to stay within the limit of the presentation, just wanted to give you some quotations, but I want to skip them. So the deployment also is a crucial parameter. What we saw during the research is that they were trying to access the labor market, but they faced adversities regardless their legal status, which means that the opportunities that they were offered to them, they're quite limited. For example, some Congolese men, one Iraqi woman, and 2 Somali women have been worked, although they had a different background of education, completing higher educational studies and working as an English teacher, and others having some other occupational skills. They were actually considered as low-skilled. They had only the opportunity to work as a housekeeper, a house painter, and respectively receiving low pays. Another interviewee from Congo said in that context that I lost my job at a moving company during the pandemic. The boss said, we don't have work now. It's the pandemic. It's difficult to find a job now, he said. Another male from Afghanistan mentioned that I was in Athens looking for a job in a restaurant, and the man asked me, are you vaccinated? Show me some proof. Is everyone vaccinated at the place you live? He had asked me if I was staying in a camp. I felt strange, like being interrogated again. Another interviewee from Morocco mentioned that his employer actually told him that I have to work 4 hours, not 8 hours. He said he cannot pay more, but I agreed I could not stop as I need the money, also due to the pandemic. We do understand that during that particular period, the examples and the understandings and, of course, the difficulties that they have impacts their prospects. And in this context, the difficulties to access a stable job, it is not something new for them. Before the pandemic, they experience instabilities. And during the pandemic, the job-seeking procedure was hindered. And after the pandemic, we do understand that the difficulties still exist. Another point here is education. The main point raised by the interviewees, especially in Greece, was that the whole educational programs, the support of the Greek language, or the Greek language, actually ceased. They were not under any implementation during that procedure, that period. That, of course, impacted children living with their parents. They couldn't access online teaching and education, distance education, due to the fact that they didn't have the sources. Those residing in open hospitality facilities couldn't access an open Wi-Fi, or the facility could not support too many connections. Or if they were living in an apartment or in a residence, they didn't have the equipment. For example, if they had two children or three children. One example here, in the camp, my daughter did not have access to online lessons because we had a weak Wi-Fi signal, while others did not have a tablet. She was disappointed. We do understand that not only youths but were impacted by the pandemic, but also those who the adults, especially because the educational support that they were receiving was a corridor to access a better job position or to be hired, to show some knowledge of the Greek language or English in order to have better opportunities. Another point here has to do, of course, with housing. As you understood, individuals in open facilities can leave the facility, can search for another facility, but as you understand, the income levels that they have hinder those aspects. What most of them were trying to do is starting their life in a living, and their everyday life in a metal container with accommodation facility, is to try to find let's say a way out through friends, through personal networks, to have access in another condition. Even the food supplies and the conditions that they were receiving in the facilities are problematic. A male from Syria mentioned that the food is not edible, for example, or the food has gone off by the time it reaches us, a female from Somalia mentioned. The lack of room to prepare to cook something, or showering facilities, or the absence of heating, the power outages, or the reduced meals, the lack of cleanliness are some of the thematic analysis codes that we identified. Also, another point here is that when some of them were trying to live with others, friends, individuals from their personal networks, they have to meet other challenges, more deterioration of their living conditions. In this context, we do understand that the understandings and the possibilities that are given to them are quite limited. Another point here that I want to give emphasis is that, as you heard before, they were trying to establish some connections with the communities, or the already established communities, if they exist, for example, in the city that they reside. So the community participation was an important parameter that supports, or tries actually to support, intercultural coexistence. It's not only the everyday needs, but the presence of the community, especially at local level, is quite crucial. The network of support, we have seen in migration theory, but also in research, is crucial, especially during the pandemic, because they raised the connections that they were seeking for advice, for support, even when the restrictive measures are actually creating fear. People from the communities are living outside in another condition of housing, for example, or were employed during the pandemic, was a source for them to deal or to create some, and let's say, plans for the future to create a sort of hope for them. We do understand that they experienced racism during the pandemic, public transport, when, for example, they were trying to sit next to someone. An interview from Iraq mentions an example like that. I have often experienced racism on public transport. When I sit next to someone, they don't want to be close. Once there was an elderly lady, I was on the train with my baby. She started shouting at me to get up and give her my seat. Everybody was looking at me. I gave her my seat. An interview from Iraq. From Syria, said one day while I was at the bus stop with a lot of people, I removed my mask for a minute and a woman told me, "Put it back. You carry diseases. Do you want to get us all sick?" We do understand that the harassment and even on, in certain cases on the facilities and, of course, the problems that, of course, with violence and other racist behavior they could experience is evident in multiple examples here. So let's move to the last part of the presentation in the case of Spain. The main difference, and of course what we were able to identify here, is that Spain offers quite different contexts, although many migrants and refugees experience similar challenges. We've seen, for example, for healthcare, the interviews affirmed that they did not face problems during the pandemic. They were able to access the healthcare system. Female from Colombia said, "I always had access from the moment I arrived. I arrived in May 2018, and at the beginning of June of the same year, I was issued a health card which allowed immediate access to the health system." Another interviewee from Romania did not consider that he faced any difficulties. So we do understand here on a comparative level that Greece created barriers at the very first time. We've seen that even in 2016 there were measures in order to provide support, but later on, 3 years later, many migrants were left without health coverage in the case of Greece. The point here that also was raised in cases of individuals in Spain also had to do, just to show you the example, they were supported in certain cases, and the challenges that they were facing actually had to do with the context that allowed them to make further steps in order to deal with those challenges, actually. During the pandemic, we do understand that the individuals, for example, here, a male from Romania mentions, from Venezuela, considers it's necessary to develop a greater education towards healthcare and how immigrants do not create any problem, and of course that they seek to be vaccinated. Employment was also another parameter that needs to be taken into consideration here during the pandemic. Most of the interviewees did not report they had difficulties accessing the labor market due to the fact that the connections that they had established during before the pandemic helped them to retain. What we saw, of course, was a severe impact on their incomes. They had less payments. Some of them, of course, had problems, and they have to deal with this with their own employers. It was, as an individual mentions, that he had to, let's say, understand and adapt to a new reality. Here, an interviewee from Venezuela mentioned that I thought it through, and I realized that Spain does not repel me at all. What Spain is telling me is to train with us and get experience with us. Another interview from Venezuela adds that it is not very easy to find a job. The issue of work is difficult, but if you're a hard worker, you definitely find something. You're a foreigner in the good sense of the word with training in your country, so you can work to practice, improve yourself here. We do understand that they have a different approach due to the fact that the labor market offer different opportunities in a limited level in comparison with Greece. For example, what an individual from Romania being in Spain for 16 years specifically asserts, once you get a job and you're good at it, you can keep it. Education, of course, was a parameter that this context, of course, created difficulties, although some of them faced obstacles in Spain in order to validate their degrees, for example. One of the reasons of the lack of information or incorrect information from the public administrations and agencies, a female from Colombia said, initially, I was told I could not validate my studies until I have settled my legal situation. I did not question that. I did not seek any information. During the pandemic, I had no information. I had no any other possibility to for validation. All was wrong. Just moving on to stay with the time. I know I'm over a few minutes. Housing, of course, is another parameter that we need to take into consideration. Of the people who took part of the research, only two were owners of an apartment in which they lived. All others were living, were renting, actually, accommodation. However, they plan, they create some ideas of hope and stability, especially regarding their establishment in the country and particularly on their accommodation. Just moving on to with the time. Another parameter is, of course, the intercultural coexistence here as well and the community participation. Only four of those interviewed were members of a community association. An interviewee from Colombia, who's a member of Association Huelva that aims to help people of Latin American origin, mentioned that it is a space that he can be helped, he can get advice, especially on what he described what a migrant needs. They're given legal advice during the pandemic, and it was a channel, actually, that they used in order to get information about the vaccinations, about their rights, and during these measures. Seven of the interviewees believe that the pandemic has brought about a change in how they interact with people. For example, an interviewee from Colombia states, I have never been very close to another person, but now I'm even more skeptical. Others believe, for example, that the pandemic affected the circle of their contacts. And as we understand, this is quite crucial, especially in accessing labor market or other opportunities. Another case here that we also identified is that the familial situation or any context in the context of couples and family affected, and of course the network of contacts and friends was also impacted. Just a few things, a few last things before mentioning some conclusions. I don't want to stay here more. So integration describes an individual or a group process that seeks to adapt in a new country and a new reality. It's a dynamic process. We do understand that between member states of the EU and, of course, the needs of the individuals, there are differences. And what we also saw between, for example, a common point here is that the promotion of fundamental rights is crucial. We've seen that in some cases Greece has a lot of steps to take, but Spain in other cases provides more opportunities, equal opportunities, especially on some levels. Another point is that in Greece we have almost exclusive concentration in precarious low status jobs, especially in undeclared contexts, that creates and mentalities of atypical ways of living and, of course, exceptionally limited social benefits and insecurity. Due to the fact that the health sector was challenged, and of course, all individuals were affected by the measures of the pandemic, we do understand that the measures actually impacted their living conditions in certain cases in both countries, and also we saw that they caused some difficulties in adapting to a new environment of the measures of the pandemic, and of course created some barriers about the next steps that they want to take. Taking into consideration, especially in Greece and in some cases in Spain, the progress that was already made by the time of the pandemic and the measures that were taken was affected. In some cases, we saw that it was severely affected, but in other cases, with the support of contact networks and the communities and the role that they played was crucial. We saw that there was a difference in the frequency of testing and treatment. There were a difference between the natives and migrants regarding the mobility restrictions. Delays in vaccination, for example, in Greece, about 7-8 months later than the general population, and even delays on administrative issues. We saw, for example, that applications stopped the examinations until, of course, these services to be able to address those issues in another way. What we saw also it is that the association between the negative understanding of migrant and the association of his presence with the COVID embedded in social consciousness and created further vulnerabilities and, of course, forms of precariousness. I would like to thank you for attention. I don't want to take more of the time. I think I will stop here. Thank you very much. You will be able to see some of the results of the Greek cases in this publication. Now we're working on the more detailed about the Spanish case. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Theodoros, for your presentation. Thank interesting you. Comparison between both countries. Tenemos tiempo para debate, preguntas. I think tenemos más o menos 15 minutos.
Yeah.
Sorry, with the micro. Yeah, we get caught.
Okay, better. I was a bit curious about the comparison between the Greek and the Spanish data because it seems, at least in the examples, the people interviewed were natural Spanish speakers.
Can you repeat about the language? You said about they were Spanish speakers?
Yes, it seems like in the interviews you showed about the job situation,
yes,
that there are native Spanish speakers and the interviews with the people in Greek, they're not native speaker, no? So it seems a little bit different. Its situation, no?
Of course.
So I would be interested, do you have any data from not Spanish speakers in the study, or did they have the same experiences?
Yeah. Should I answer this and to gather other questions?
We can.
Okay. What?
Hay otras preguntas, si podemos hacer dos, tres preguntas, no? Y a common answer, it's going to be better.
I don't know if pertinent, but okay. For example, for what concerns the harmonization of processes in general among member states, not only, European member states.
I heard something about the harmonization of, can you repeat the whole question?
Harmonization?
Yes.
Can you hear me? Okay. Yeah. Sorry. No, because first of all, a compliment because the topic is why, let's say, is very big, is huge, take different aspect, no? But I was wondering, for example, what about during the COVID, let's say, the harmonization of the processes of the different, at least EU member states. So here you presented the case of Greece and Spain. For example, in my case, I'm Italian, but I was working also in Malta, Cyprus, hotspot. So, for example, and also, for example, not only in the facility, in the integration, let's say, in all the area, but also, for example, what about the disembarkation processes, the quarantine on the sea, and also about, let's say, the condition of the camp. For example, you refer some interview in reminded, for example, they start in a container, but I think this was kind of luxury somehow. So just about harmonization, let's say, if your study covered this, and also especially for what concerned the, it's called, let's say, the relocation program, which shall be somehow a common point. That's it.
Thank you.
Thank you. My question relates to the first one that was asked, and it's very short. It's about the criteria that was used for the selection of the participants. Mm-hmm. If you could explain that. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
We can answer these things.
Okay, thank you very much for the questions. Not all of them were, well, let's say, weren't speaking the language very well. Some of them, yes, that they were also have a different understanding. This is, I assume that this is what we want to say, somebody who has spent more time and, of course, knows the language of, this was something that we didn't see in Greece, because the problem is that in Spain we're able to reach that point, but in Greece it could take even... We know people, we interviewed people that have been in the country for 10 or more years and they barely know the basic words. And they rely to others to help them in accessing. For example, in the Spanish sample, four were very well speakers. They were speakers of the Spanish language. All the others, we can say that they have average understanding and they were able to deal with everyday needs. But I agree that this is why we also took that as a parameter. We do understand that education and accessing and support, it is something that is associated with the second question of harmonization. We've seen that actually the differences and the impact actually that these non-harmonization, I would say, exists creates or destroys their opportunities, create glimpses of what they can do, but due to the fact that there is no harmonization, we have seen differences between, I also mentioned some, we also found some from their own understandings, where in some facilities were treated differently, where they were receiving more information, but even on relocation, as you said, or even on voluntary return, or support, or accessing asylum processes, but or support that they can find, especially on for those who were recognized, is quite problematic here, because the harmonization is not only has to do with the legal aspects, as we do understand, is this the case of the what happens next and the dynamic of its, for example, labor market and its society affects them. So. Another point here that I hope I covered the first question about language importance and, of course, how it is connected. On the second question, just to stay here a bit more, the COVID processes, as you said before, and I completely agree, were quite different. Even in Greece, as I mentioned before, because you said Italy. Italy was also a case that I was in last year in Naples, conducted some interviews, and individuals were actually, for me, being in Greece and able to compare these understandings that they had of those experiences are quite different. We've seen that individuals, in general, are towards uncertainties and fear and exclusion, but the processes that its country is, creates different understandings and opportunities. I can give you an example that in Greece, the process of informing and preparing children on the facilities was so much delayed that we have the presence, for example, of international organizations such as UNICEF to start distributing leaflets in, translated in 11 languages in order to inform the parents. Another point here is that adults weren't able to use sanitary measures, face masks and others in the same, at the same time for a whole facility. This, of course, creates different dynamics, different mechanisms of dealing with the situation. And if you ask me, I've seen that even at EU level, the whole process is to establish a common procedure, maybe on asylum, on dealing with the rights, but we do understand that the dynamics are quite different. And this is where this harmonization fails. I hope I covered this question, and of course I do agree about the relocation, and it is also, we've seen that even the whole procedure of accessing asylum was challenged between states, between cases and at periods, but at the same time we've seen that formal processes were actually also supported. And it was the civil society and the communities of those who are volunteers, who have seen lawyers, who have seen activists support towards the retention of those mercers towards the change. We've seen that, for example, the solidarity movement in Greece, but also in other countries, played a crucial role. But if you ask me, the lacks and the gaps of harmonization of all those processes are more evident once the support networks, could be the civil society, could be the solidarians, could be the NGOs, could be the international organizations that after 5 years, for example, is not supporting the program because it is transferred according to the European Commission to the authority playing of the authority of the state. That has to do with that. So we do understand that here is the main problem, that there was not enough planned strategy at many levels, and once a corridor of support is not there, is missing, we see that that harmonization is not working. This is why. I hope I covered that. Also about the criteria. We chose individuals who have been in the country more than 5 years in both cases. Adults, men, women, and also we tried to see, this is of course it was a small sample in the case of Spain and in Greece if you ask me, because the differences, the dynamics, looking at actually on a mixed population. We've seen migrants, some of them were recognized refugees, very few of them were asylum seekers, creates this non-harmonization actually impacts on their processes. They deal with different opportunities, and at the same time, the labor market or the housing market or education support or healthcare, the gaps that exist there actually create more evidence of those vulnerabilities. And I hope I covered this about the sample. If you have any other question, I'm at your disposal.
Any more question?
Thank you for your presentation. I also have a question about sampling, and I was wondering why, was there a reason why the Greek sample was much larger than the Spanish sample? That's one question. And then at one point in your presentation you showed us a map of Europe and the hotspots of migration, and so I was wondering why did you decide to make this comparison between Greece and Spain and not choose another country, for example, between Greece and Italy, for example? Thank you.
Thank you for the question. Of course.
The last questions.
Okay. Is there another question? Okay. Thank you so much for the question. Regarding the other countries, it has to do only with funding and the whole procedure. How it we began with a Greek sample and the study design, but due to funding difficulties and implementing the research there, it took us it was a bit delayed in implementing, and the program had, as you know, in every single case, a specific timeline. But yes, to connect it with the other countries that you said, for example, in Italy, this is why I mentioned that I was in Italy a couple of months ago, implementing more interviews with people there. This is something that has to do with only the capacity of the funding and the extension of the funding actually to continue it. This was the only reason. the plan is to return, on those countries again and to see what has happened more after 2 or 3 years. I completely agree that, for example, the resources, how they are given and implemented, allocated actually, in each country case was the one of the parameters that created more difficulties for us. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Podemos ya dar pues, por finalizada la sesión. Muchas gracias por la asistencia y les emplazamos a la próxima conferencia de la Mediterránea. Gracias.